Direct selling has become an extremely popular business model across industries in India. We discuss the shortcomings and future prospects of this model. The India Economic Conclave organized a panel discussion on direct selling, redefining retail.
Disruption is the new rule of the game. Online marketplaces are giving traditional sellers clearly a run for their money. And trust me, this is not everyone's game. For everyone's successful product, there are hundreds of failed startups, although their names never hit the headlines. You need a different attitude, kind of daredevil approach, to really stay in the game, forget about winning.
And our upcoming session, Aisha, is going to focus on a very interesting topic. New ideas for disruptive retail through direct selling, the unconventional outreach.
I'll start with Zaheer, who's Director of Legal and Corporate Affairs, QI Group of Companies. On one hand, there are many initiatives that government is taking to promote entrepreneurship. On the other hand, there are some existing business models who are probably facing, I would say they are struggling because of the regulatory framework in which India operates, be it online retail, be it direct selling. So as one of the largest direct selling companies globally, what's your take on that?
Direct selling has been in India for many years now, I think well over 20 years. And what is interesting is about 20 years back, the RBI actually stated that direct selling does not come under the purview of RBI. And what happened in 2016 was in September 2016, this fantastic set of guidelines came about from the Department of Consumer Affairs in India. And what the regulations and these guidelines actually did was that it militated for consumer protection, obviously. It organized the industry. So you then begin to have now clear definitions on the setting up of direct selling businesses. You have contracts between direct sellers and distributors. And the entity which undertakes this. You then have obligations between direct sellers as well, which is mitigated for. You have protection of the consumer. Most importantly, you then have a monitoring agency which comes into place as well. So I think kudos to the government for allowing these guidelines to come about into place.
We have Mr. Vijay Sardana with us from Delhi, who's joining us from Delhi. He has prepared a full-fledged report for ASSOCHAM, which was presented to the government. And it has a lot of clarifications as far as direct selling and disruptive retail in India is concerned. Vijay, thank you for joining us. So what is your take? You know, I mean, your report highlighted a couple of key issues regarding this sector. If you can just throw some light on that.
Direct selling, actually, when we look at this country needs a lot of employment opportunities. And in conventional businesses, there's a lot of capital requirement and a lot of infrastructure requirement if you have to create employment. Direct selling is one option where somebody is manufacturing, ensuring quality, packaging and everything, and people are, without any massive infrastructure, can go to any place and start doing selling and start earning by providing a product which is across the table, so quality is assured and everything is assured. See, the challenge here it was that there was no guidelines. So what was happening that every state or every agency was interpreting the whole thing in their own way. This is a concern in the whole system. So we requested Government of India that if you really want to promote employment, you have to give some platform to grow these entrepreneurs, those who are operating virtually at very small capacity with the capital. And most of them are either unemployed youth, ladies, or aged people, those who can operate from home. And I think this was a fantastic platform on which government can create employment. Government of India accepted this positive development. They created a guideline. But still, I find that many states still debating, either due to lack of priority or lack of interest
right.
or lack of understanding, we don't know. But I think this is very important that any opportunity which helps in employment creation, we should take it on priority.
Sunil. Now, you know, you have curated many businesses, you have curated many brands. There is one very stark disconnect. On one hand, we are trying to create jobs, we are trying to create entrepreneurship. There are businesses where I think we need a more clear picture if we really have to hit that $5 trillion mark.
Say for the smaller entrepreneur today, I mean, you take, for instance, the people who created Flipkart. It started in a garage. You take Forest Essentials, you take Paperboat. They are going all into the the system of disrupting the retail area because they don't have the money, first and foremost, to pay distributors and then retailers and everybody else to give a margin. And therefore, when you come up with an idea and you want to promote it by yourself first before an investor comes in, you want to disrupt. You want to disrupt at a low cost. And that's where retail comes into play. If you are a small-scale entrepreneur, or you have to be small-scale initially, that the first thing you have to do is, does your product have a difference? Are you marketing in a crowded market? And no matter how much of disruption you do, you're not going to succeed because the big guys are already there. So you have to look for something which is unique in your product. You have to work on a low-cost model, which must be real. And then when you disrupt, there's a big difference between direct selling and direct marketing. And that's where I want to draw a line, because direct selling and direct marketing should never be confused. Direct selling is when you go door to door, whether you're B2B or B2C, you are able to talk to people directly, and then you go in. Now with the mobile coming in, and everybody's got the social network going, it makes direct selling a lot easier and direct marketing as well, because you can market your brand and hope that the consumer will listen to you and go out and buy. Look for a product which you can really disrupt, and then go in for the cheapest form of retailing, which is available now with direct selling and everything else. And you've got everything in now to move ahead.
So we have, in fact, Mr. Ashok with us from Smartway Group of Companies, who has successfully operated this model in India. So Ashok, I want you to share your own experience, because remarkable thing about this part of retail is that it creates a lot of employment opportunities for women. Do you think this direct selling or disruptive retail can play a crucial role in that?
See, multi-level marketing is one of the biggest opportunity in India, especially a country like India, and especially for the women, no doubt about that. But to get into that industry or to become an entrepreneur in multi-level or direct sales industry, we need to support them for everywhere and each and every position of their life. According to the survey, creating entrepreneurs, India is on the 68th rank out of 137 countries. So where are we? And why we are not looking in seriously into these type of problems and aspects of this direct selling industry?
Yeah.
So we have to be more on the regulatory part. We have to be more on the, we have to give all the governments. Now, central government did a very good job, fantastic job, that they at least recognize something.
And but state told, governments have been lagging in recognizing or adopting the law.
They have given the instruction to the state governments to implement and make a monitoring mechanism. So there the industry start getting booming again.
Right.
So we should believe that there is a big industry behind us and we are going to take it further.
Right. Zahir, you want to add to that?
If you talk about female empowerment, 58% of women are involved in direct selling. That's no different in India. I think you have a larger proportion involved. Globally, you're talking of 68% of women. So if you're talking about women empowerment as well, then that's very strong positive that the industry brings towards you.
Sandeep, I'll pull you in at this point. Do you think the direct selling or the disruptive retail online, online retail, somewhere it will all converge into a formal organized retail, which is still a very minimal part of the total retail that happens in India?
If you look at the, let's say, online retail or e-commerce, USA is largest retail market. 95% of United States retail market is organized. McKinsey did a survey where they found out that people like to shop within 15 minutes radius where they live. But still, e-commerce is close to 10% of the total retail. But if you look at India, it's still, less than 2% of the total retail is e-commerce. We are global consumer. We are consumers similar to someone in Tokyo, London, Paris, Chicago, or San Francisco. So we will, in terms of our income level, exposure level, everything is evolving. And is our physical retail giving everything which we are hoping? And answer is no, right? I have created two marketplaces. It's just a power of online that you can aggregate, like if you look at any of the famous Flipkart, for that matter, or Amazon India, they would have easily $10, $15 billion worth of listed inventory coming from 500,000 different sellers. Mm. Does not matter how much capital you have, you can't create that on a physical infrastructure basis. So my point is, physical will stay there, direct marketing will be there, direct selling will be there, but e-commerce is here to stay, and if US and China are the precursor to what will happen to Indian retail, I would like to say that, you know, maybe by 2025, you know, 8 to 10% of Indian retail could be e-commerce.
Right. When we talk of direct selling in India's context, also I think what needs to be focused on is that there are tier 2, tier 3, tier 4 cities where there is a genuine employment problem. Can this actually, at a very small level obviously, but can this be an alternate, I would say, career opportunity in those towns as well, where maybe the online retail is yet to really get its grip?
Direct selling is wonderful at creating jobs, because what happens is, if you become a direct seller for any of these party plan companies, or direct selling companies, or multi-level marketing companies, many, many different names, all of a sudden, you are going to require things like a website. I mean, I was involved in a direct selling company many years ago and had great success back in Australia. And the way it worked is, I positioned myself as an opinion leader in Australia around marketing for small business. I found a direct selling company that was an ideal, they had an ideal product for small businesses in Australia. I then needed a website. I then started a podcast, so I needed an editor. I started doing videos. I needed a copywriter for my website. I got into personal development, because direct selling is a fantastic business model for personal development. It's a very inspirational industry. So all of a sudden, I found myself employing, whether full-time or in a contractual or freelance basis, quite a number of people. And that's really exciting. As a small business owner, when you know you're giving employment to others, it was a great feeling. So it's a very, very good industry for employing.
Thank you so much, all of you.
Influence Initiative.